Okay, so tell us about computer search for those in all community knowledge.
Thank you. Thanks very much to the organisers. I'm really enjoying the workshop. So I'm having a technical problem, but my talk is here. I was hoping to demonstrate some software, but my laptop, I think, is dying. That's where the software is. So I'll tell you about it in any case, but we may not be able to show something I was hoping to show you. I will just give a little advertisement for this software, Kirby Calculator, which you can find at www.kirbycalculator.net, written by Frank Swenton, who is a collaborator on the work I'm talking about, but he is sole author of the software. I just use it. So this is really nice software for handling knots and also Kirby diagrams. So it can do Kirby calculus for you. It can also perform isotopies of knot diagrams in a very convenient, hands-on way. It will give you certain knot variants. And basically, we've also built in a search for, as the title says, ribbon alternating knots. Before I go on, I'm just going to give you a very basic description of what we're trying to do. So what we're trying to do is, so let's say given, so consider a set of R equals a set of knots formed from an n component unlink. Say n plus 1 component unlink by n band moves. So this is something we've seen in at least one talk today. I'll give you an example. So we take three component unlink, and then we join them together using some bands, which basically means we take some thickened up arc and wrap it around a little bit. And attach two of these together. And then we say, well, we've got to do a little bit more work. And attach this one.
Is that a bad choice of color?
Is that a bad choice of color? I was told this is the good choice.
Yeah. I mean, maybe push it harder.
Okay, it doesn't matter. You can imagine what I've drawn. So we'll just take some little rectangular strips with their ends on two different components. And, you know, take the constraint is that you take one less than the number of unlinked components you started with and apply in such a way that you're left with a knot, which exactly means, you know, if you took the graph whose vertices are your original components and edges are simply given by the bands, it should be a tree. It should be a connected graph and a tree. Okay, so we call that, maybe I'll call this the union of Rn. So we can do this for a two-component unlink, three-component unlink, four-component unlink, and this gives you a set called R. And the question is sort of a silly one, perhaps. Now, given a knot K, is K one of these knots? So, which knots are formed in this way and which knots are not? Can we meaningfully answer this question in any way? Can we approach it with a computer? And in particular, what is this set of knots? This is a hard question, so I will end up restricting my attention to, instead of any knots, I'll talk about a very restricted class, which is alternating knots. And I'll tell you what those are as the talk proceeds. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to do here. Okay, moving on. So a knot is a smooth, simple, closed curve in S3, help to smooth isotopy. Here's an example. is not an alternating knot. You can see, well, I'll tell you later what alternating is. But this is a non-alternating diagram because this term goes over and over. And this particular knot, in fact, does not admit an alternating diagram, although that needs some work to show that. A knot is sliced. So what I'm interested in is slice knots. This is sort of a four-dimensional topology definition. It undoubtedly is, although what we'll see is sort of on the borderline between three and four-dimensional topology. You can address the question in terms of something like what I've talked about on that board, and you can sort of see it as a more knot theoretical three-dimensional topology. But what is a knot? A slice knot is a knot which bounds a smoothly embedded two-disc into four walls. So these were discussed in a paper of our team in 1925, and probably modern research on them really started in 1957, the famous paper of Fox and Milner. And why is it called a slice knot? So I'll just draw a picture which tells you why it's a slice knot. So slice is equivalent to a slice of a two knot. So just like a one-dimensional knot is a S1 into S3, a two knot is an S2 into S4. And if you wanted to, here's a picture of S4. Here's a two knot. How would you study that? Well, you could sort of, if you wanted to get a three-dimensional picture, you take a cross section. So you cut this with an S3. And then what you get here would be a slice knot. And so here I described it in terms of a ball, and here, of course, you get two discs on either side, sitting inside a four ball. And conversely, if you just have a slice disc in a four ball, you can double, and then you see that you're a slice of a two knot. So this is the reason for the terminology slice. Okay, what did I want to, oh yes, so these are useful. So let me give a little bit of motivation, which is not going to be relevant for the rest of the talk. Useful in four-dimensional topology. So one way they're useful in four-dimensional topology is if you, well, it's useful to know if knots are sliced. More generally, it's useful to know what is the minimal genus of a surface that they bound in the four ball. This is related to a key smooth invariant of smooth four manifolds, which is the genus function. Have a homology class in a closed form manifold, you're very interested in knowing what's the minimal genus surface that represents it. If you have a Kirby diagram where you're attaching two handles along knots, you know that you're attaching a disc in the core of that two handle. So if you know the genus of the surface that bounds before you put that on, you at least have an upper bound on the genus function for a homology class. So in some sense, knowing about slice knots and four ball genus is related to knowing about genus functions of four manifolds. A different use, which I've put on the slide here, existence of a topologically sliced, smoothly non-sliced knot implies existence of the Dirac structure on R4. So I'm working in the smooth category, I'm interested in smoothly embedded disks. You can also, as we heard in a previous talk, talk about locally, flatly, topologically embedded disks, work in a topological category, and due to the big black box of Friedman's theorem that we heard about a couple of days ago, there are known to be, for example, any knot with Alexander polynomial 1 is topologically sliced. So if you can show that one is, such a knot is not smoothly sliced, then there's a construction which gives you an exotic R4, which is a pretty interesting thing to have. I won't go into any details on that at the moment. But this was used quite recently, about 10 years ago or so, by Jake Rasmussen, to show that combining Friedman's theorem with Kovanov homology and Jake's S invariant gives you an existence of exotic R4 without needing any Donaldson theory or any gauge theory whatsoever. So Kovanov homology can be used to show that there are exotic R4s using this fact about, you know, because it can be used to show there's a smoothly non-sliced knot with Alexander polynomial. Okay. One can exhibit, so we're interested in, let's say we're interested in knowing about surfaces bounded by a knot, and in particular, is there a disk bounded by a knot? You need to have a way of getting your hands on these, so you get your hands on these with a, it's called a movie, so let me just give you an idea what I mean by that. I'll give you a couple of examples. So a movie for a slice disk. So I'll warm up with, instead of taking a slice disk in the 4-ball, I'll look for a slice disk in the 3-ball. So I'll exhibit one because we can just draw it. So how shall I draw that? Let's just take a little block of the 4-ball, of the 3-ball. So here's the boundary. I run out of space, but it's okay. Here's the boundary of the 3-ball here, and here's the interior. And I will take a nice knot in S2. Here's one. And I want to draw a disk. So what will a disk look like? Well, we'll perturb it so that the radial distance function, the distance from the center of the ball, gives you a Morse function. And then what you'll see is some nice topological events happening as you go into the ball. For example, it may look like this. So this is your disk. And you see that you have some maxima, some minima, and some saddles. And then we draw a movie by just looking at successive slices in between the critical points. And for this baby example, we'll see something like, first we have a knot, then beside the knot, here's this maximum, which gives a new circle, and then those two join together, give you a single knot again, and then those two split apart, and then these disappear. So somehow, from here to here, at a maximum, which is basically a circle appears, a knot appears. From here to here we have saddles, and from here we have minima. What I want to sort of emphasize here by using the invisible red chalk is how do you show in the movie what's going to happen to the saddle? Well, you just draw a little rectangle, which is a band move. And as you pass the saddle, you're going to replace the two ends of the rectangle with the two sides. So if you're going that way, you'll draw it like this, and you'll draw it here. And if you wanted to see it in reverse, if you wanted to reverse the movie, you just put a dual band move that undoes the first one. Okay, so this sort of works. So I'm taking red bands to go this way, and blue bands to go that way. You can run the movie backward or forward, it's slightly different. So what happens if you do this, in the 4-ball, well, now you do the same thing, but you're looking at slices which are S3 instead of S2. So instead of always seeing unlinks, you get to see more interesting links. But the local picture, what happens at a saddle, still happens in a plane. So you still get to draw that the same way. You still just draw a band. The band is allowed to be twisted up a little bit more. So let's just take an example in a 4-ball. Well, I'll take an example that I work extensively with in this talk, which is called the Stevedore's knot, or 6-1, or 6A3, if you use some other terminology, which causes some confusion to me from time to time. So what do we do? Well, we start with our knot, and then we simply add a band, and that band is going to, now we have a little bit of room, we can twist our band. If you don't like twisted bands, you can just put a rhizomyster 1 in the knot diagram, and then put an untwisted band. But there's my band, and then this gives you gives you this. So you go by a band move. And then you stare at this for a while, and maybe you color in one of the components. You see that it's a two-component link, and you see that it can be simplified in various ways. So you see that it's isotopic to the unlink. And then that's all you need. So that's your movie. Okay, so this sequence of basically three pictures shows that Steve Lord's not Don's slice. All right, great. Okay, so in general, if you wanted to have such a movie, you can sort of arrange that maxima happen near the top, and then saddles happen, and then minima. You can do a little bit of Smale-type rearrangement of your Morse function and critical points. So the first thing you would typically do is draw a collection of unknotted split circles beside your knot, and then you would have some band moves, and then you would have some minima, and then you would check with the Euler characteristic, check that you made something orientable with the Euler characteristic 1 and you conclude it's a disk. But what I'm going to do is, for simplicity, assume that there are no maxima. So a knot is ribbon. Now we should be able to understand the equivalence between 4 and 3. Ribbon means it bounds a slice disk with no maxima, just like this example here. It means that there's a set of n band moves converting into the n plus 1 component. I mean, well, we put our slice disk in this nice Morse position. We have some saddles followed by some minima, and the Euler characteristic tells you there has to be one more minimum than band moves. And finally, it bounds a ribbon immersed disk in S3. So let me tell you what that is. I don't have a picture in my slide.
But when you say any of the following, these are three equivalent conditions. Is that correct?
Say again?
When you say any of the following.
Yes, these are three equivalent conditions. That's right.
Yes.
And I'm trying to wave my hands a little, convince you there. So ribbon immersed, so this is where the terminology ribbon comes from. Ribbon immersed, let me just give you an example. There is an example that comes from this picture, which may be what I'm drawing. It means it's almost embedded, but not quite. Let's see, what we can do, something like this. So here's a surface which you can see quite easily as a disk, and it's immersed, but the only singularities are what's called ribbon singularities, where locally you've got the singularity, the pre-image of the singularity looks like a cut across the disk together with a cut inside the disk. So these map to here. So you don't have the class of singularities, for example. You avoid other kinds of singularities that you might expect. You just have singularities that locally look like this. One piece cutting through the interior of another piece. How do we see that we get them from such a diagram as this? Well, you remember that you could run the movie backwards by putting a little blue band here. And when you do this isotopy, you remember where the blue band goes. So you use Kirby calculator to do the isotopy and bring the blue band back here, and it will somehow wrap around these in some way. And then you say, ah, look at that. The unlink is bounding these two disks, and the band just cuts through it, making some ribbon sequence. So this is how we see that, well, at least some of the implications between these three equivalent conditions. Okay. Any questions? Is that right?
How unique is the ribbon immersed disk?
Not unique at all. Yeah. Actually, no. There are certainly examples where it's not unique. I don't know. There may be. I mean, you can always do something trivial. You can always introduce a cancelling pair of saddle and a minimum, there are certainly knots which have more than one isotopic class of ribbon discs. If you allow slice discs, you can connect, you can do a connect some with a two knot in the interior of the four wall to get a non-ribbon slice disc. So you can get certainly countably many of those. I don't know the answer. Non-unique is the answer really of that. Okay, and I wanted to tell you another construction which will come up a little bit later. Symmetric unions are slice. So let me tell you. What is a symmetric union?
A ribbon or a slice?
They are, so they are ribbon, yes.
Okay.
They are ribbon. And I'll show you why they are ribbon. So for any, so first easy construction is for any k, k connect sum minus k is slice. I won't tell you what I mean by k connect sum minus k, I'll just draw a picture. But maybe I can tell you, connect sum with the mirror reverse, which basically means you draw some two tangle, or is this a one tangle? It's the one tangle. You draw something, draw some knotted arc, and then you reflect it across an axis of symmetry. And what you get is k connect sum minus k. How do we see this is ribbon? Well, you just stare at it a little bit and you say this axis of symmetry is passing through this in 2 points. I will just rotate the whole thing around the back, around this axis, and I'll get an immersed surface in S3 that way. If this was just trivial, I'd get a trivial disk around the back. But now, as we go, this piece is going to, for each crossing, the piece in front is going to cut through the piece behind. And what's that going to mean? It's going to mean you're seeing a ribbon singularity appearing. So you get a, well, you get a ribbon singularity for each crossing. But you get this immersed disk. In particular, though, you may note that a piece of the disk is just given by. So this is a piece of the disk. If I take some arc here and here, it just swings around, and that's a piece of the disk. Sort of sitting in there, that's just a piece of the disk. Right there, and also right here. So if I were to twist those up in some arbitrary number of crossings, I would still have a disk. I'm just putting some crossings in a little band like this. So in other words, and this is where you go from just a connect sum to a symmetric union. You just start putting some number of crossings across the middle. I don't have space to do more, but I could do 10 crossings here and 11 crossings here if I feel like it. I just complicate it by twisting it up down the axis of symmetry, and I still have something ribbon. And the state of affairs is that nobody knows if slice, so what do we know? Slice implies ribbon. We don't know that. Other way. Ribbon implies slice, and symmetric union implies ribbon. And it's unknown these implications are. Probably shouldn't, but nobody can show that. There are some potential, there's some good potential counterexamples. You could come from Charlemagne and Thompson and Abe Tanga and others, which are known to be slice and don't look like they're ribbon. They come from some interesting Kirby diagrams for the four wall. Knowing that something is a Kirby diagram for the four ball tells you there's some slice knots involved. Turn the two handles upside down, basically. Okay, but in general, we don't know this. So symmetric unions are ribbon. Ribbon knots are slice. I'm not sure slice knots are. Okay, let me now talk about the restrictive class of knots I'm going to concern myself with. Alternating knots. A knot or link in S3 is alternating if it admits an alternating diagram. Here's an alternating diagram. It simply means as you traverse the diagram, you alternate between over, under, over, under, and so on. You never have two successive overcrossings. We can immediately tell many geometric properties from an alternating diagram. So alternating diagrams have always been a little bit mysterious. You can tell an awful lot from them. I seem to have a lot of information. Just for a sample, this knot is prime. It's not a connect sum of two non-trivial knots. And it has no mutants. You can't find a Conway sphere, a sphere that cuts through in 4 points, leaving something non-trivial inside. That was shown by Minasco in 1902. It has genus 2, so Crowell and Murasugi in the 1950s showed that if you apply Seifert's algorithm to an alternating diagram, you get the Seifert genus. More recently, Duncan McCoy showed that if a knot has a knotting number 1, so we heard a knotting number is a difficult problem, could be undecidable, who knows. Maybe, could a knotting number 1 be undecidable? Yes, but a knotting number 1 is definitely decidable for alternating knots. You simply look at any given alternating diagram, try all the crossings, none of them works. It's not a knotting number 1. So a knotting number 1, unknotting crossings of unknotting number 1 alternating knots show up in alternating diagrams. So that was proven using some similar methods to what I'm going to talk about today, Donaldson's theorem and Haggard's third theory. He used them a lot more intensively than I'm going to. Okay, so wishful thinking is actually what this talk is about. The basis for the talk is wishful thinking. So here's what I'd love to be able to do. Find an algorithm to decide if a given alternating knot is slice or ribbon. Can't do it. Classify slice or ribbon alternating knots in some sensible way. A recursive description if you have an algorithm that will give you all the ribbon alternating knots with less than 107 crossings, for example, if you wait long enough. Don't know how to do that yet. And determine whether slice alternating knots are ribbon. Sadly, don't have to do that either. So we don't know how to do any of these, but these are things I'd love to be able to do. Right. Okay, moving on. Alternating links. So this slide is really just a bit of background. Won't need it much. It's sort of to give an idea why this alternating property plays nicely with four-dimensional topology. This is one fun way I see this. So Josh Green and Josh Howie, independently 2 years ago, gave a beautiful geometric classification of what it means to be alternating. So instead of talking about existence of an alternating diagram, this is something much more satisfying. So another link. So I'm giving you the Josh Green version, which is a small translation of the Josh Howie version. Another link is alternating if and only if it admits two spanning surfaces in S3 whose Gordon-Lithman forms are definite products in science. So I'm going to talk more about Gordon-Lithman invariants, or Gordon-Lithman forms, but let me just tell you a little idea what's going on here. So one direction of this was known a long, long time ago, probably to Gerrits in the 30s, I'm not sure. Take an alternating diagram and do chessboard coloring, as Licorice calls it, which I like. Checkerboard coloring is also commonly used. So color it like this. This, as you can see, is the black surface, and this is the white surface. So what do we do? Well, if one of these happens to be orientable like this, we just take the Seifert pairing on it. Familiar Seifert pairing where you take, it's a pairing on the first homology, you take two curves, you want to produce a number from them, you take the linking number of one with the orient normal push off of the other. So you push off one of them into S3, you take a linking number. Gordon-Lithman generalized that to non-orientable surfaces. So if you take a curve in a non-orientable surface, and if you take two curves in a non-orientable surface, there aren't too many curves around here as well. Let's take another one. drawn. Well, so the linking number is now, well, you don't have a choice of oriented normal to push off, so you push off both sides at once. Take the linking number with that. It's the Gordon difference. So it's not hard to see, it's an easy exercise or a little practice, that the black and white surface from an alternating diagram, one is always positive definite, one is always negative. So those are the alternating surfaces. That's one direction of this. And then if you have two such surfaces, it turns out you there's a nice three-dimensional argument that you try to minimize the number of, well, you try to minimize the intersection between them, you kill all closed curves in the intersection, and then you squash down the arcs, and the arcs, you end up with the union being a two-sphere, and the surfaces lie on it, and they're exactly giving you back an alternating diagram. So there is a way to rephrase this statement, which I like, although I'm not sure Josh and Josh like it. Equivalently, so you can pretend this is about four-dimensional topology, or maybe it really is. It admits two spanning surfaces of these two surfaces. What you can do is, so I won't really dwell on why this is equivalent, but it is. Here's S3 inside S4. Here's your non-relink K. You push one of the definite surfaces into one side and one into the other side, and take the double branch cover. And it turns out you always get a connect sum of CP2s out of that. So this is somehow something about full manifold.
Do they need to be disjoint?
They will be disjoint once you push them in opposite four balls.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's always positively oriented, or could it go either way?
Yeah, you're going to have to choose your orientation on it. If you do it, it can go either way. I guess if you change the coloring somehow, it depends on your conventions. But you can arrange that it's always. I could say up to overall orientation. Okay. All right, so algorithmically ribbon knot. So I'm going to now sum up what we have done. So with Frank Swent, we have implemented an algorithm to find ribbon alternating knots. So it finds lots of them, but sadly not all. So we call the knots that it finds algorithmically. So I guess I could put another category over here. Algorithmically ribbon implies ribbon, but sadly, not the other way. We need to maybe expand the algorithm a little bit or just show that it's hopeless. So I will tell you what algorithmically ribbon means, but for now let's just say what can we do. So for example, this is really a statement of experimental results, but the first sentence is actually something that needs a proof. Slice two bridge knots. So two bridge knots, what's the best way to describe a two bridge knot? Well, it's a knot that admits a diagram that looks like this. It's the plat closure of a four braid. It's known which, due to Paolo Lisca, which of those are slice, and it's known they're all ribbon. It turns out they're all algorithmically ribbon. If you look at the table of 12 crossing knots, all but one slice prime alternating knot. So that all but one is a bit sad, actually, but almost all of them are algorithmically ribbon, and all connected sums of an alternating knot with its mirror. So anytime you do this construction without the crossings down the middle, you will get something algorithmically ribbon. And we ran a search on table. Can't remember how many knots are in the table, but I have a slide later that will tell us. And we find 29,000 algorithmically prime alternating knots. I really wanted to show you one of them, but the computer's dying, so I can't.
Do you actually know all of the slice knots I mean, we don't know all the slice knots in general to 12 properties. Do we know all the alternating ones?
Yes, we do.
Yes.
The only thing we don't know about is the Kinoshita Terasaka, I think.
I thought there were a lot of 12 properties in examples of
the I don't think so. Yeah. No, I think we now know them all. Yeah. Except for that 11 crossing now. Okay. But the last 12 crossing one came out quite recently. No, I'll tell you about that later. So what do we do? Given an alternating diagram of knots, seek a sequence of band moves and isotopes. So we want to actually do what I did here. Find some band moves, find some isotopes. We want a computer to do it and end up with an unlink. So yeah, look for nice simple sequences. We're working with alternating knots. They're supposed to have nice things associated to them. So they should have nice simple slice disk movies. So starting case, so we'll start to distinguish between how many bands we need. In other words, what, you know, this thing was a three component unlink with two bands, you know, how many bands, how many components. The simplest case is that you can do it with a single saddle, a single band move. So we'll start there. We call that fusion number one. This is a terminology that exists out there. The fusion number of a ribbon knot is the smallest number of saddles you need in its ribbon disc. So we're going to look for a sequence starting with your knot, a single band move followed by an isotopy, in other words, some sequence of rhizomyosin moves or something on the diagram, ending in a two-component unlink. Okay. So there, that's what we're doing. We want to, so the principle is try to stay as alternating as possible. We'd like to try and stay in the world of alternating diagrams if we can, but we can't. Because we know the unlink does not admit a non-split alternating diagram. The reason for that is the unlink has what's called nullity. So nullity of a link a simple way of saying what it is, it's the first Betty number of the double branched cover. It's also the nullity of the cipher, the symmetrized cipher pairing, or the Gerwitz pairing, or the Gerwitz-Lithuanian form. Gerwitz-Lithuanian as well. Provided you, you work in each case with a connected surface. So nullity is something that can easily determine from the diagram, and the unlink has nullity 1. The double branch cover is S1 cross S2, which has first Betty number 1. So you can't have alternating. So the best you can do is have a single non-alternating crossing, you know, almost alternating. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to say, you know, alternating knots should be nice. Let's look for a band move that only introduces, only has a single crossing away from being alternating, and followed with an isotopic. And then we use some work of other people that tell us how to look for these. So basically, we're going to appeal to work of Gerwitz, Gordon Lifland, and Donaldson for the first part, finding the band, and Tsukamoto to find the isotope. So with Tsukamoto, well, I'll tell you now what Tsukamoto does. Tsukamoto, theorem from 2004, building on previous work of Manasco, using intersection graphs, so a classical graph theory approach to the three-manifold topology. Every almost alternating diagram with two-component unlink, that will be an example, by the way. This is an example of an almost alternating diagram with two-component unlink. I'll highlight it by maybe putting a little star on the crossing that makes it not alternating. I might also introduce my coloring convention, which is I'm going to shade in such a way that at each crossing, at alternating crossings, as you go over, the shading is on your left, and at non-alternating crossings, as you go over the overcrossing, you see the shading on the right. Okay. So the coloring sort of should be consistent if you have an alternating diagram, and you see just coloring showing up in a different way at one crossing and almost alternating diagram. So Tsukamoto has told us that every almost alternating diagram of a two-component unlink may be converted to the standard diagram of crossings by a finite sequence of flipes. So this is a familiar move where you flip the tangle over. Untongue moves. So in the untongue move, you should note that the little crossing at the top is non-alternating, and that remains the case here because the color will be the same color pattern. So you preserve the number of non-alternating crossings, and you decrease the number of alternating crossings. You can have a right dimensional one, killing alternating crossing, and you can have a single right dimensional two at the end of the day. At some point, you're going to see a diagram of the two-component unlink. This is sort of the last move as you go from here to crossing this diagram. So this is really nice because a computer can just look for all of these in a diagram. Quite quickly find them all and try them all out. And there's a sort of, there's also a note that this is monotone. The flipe is preserving the number of crossings, everything else is reducing the number of crossings. So this gives you a nice finite algorithm that will terminate. Okay, here's an example, the stevedore, which I indicated where the band move is algorithmically ribbon. So let's just see that we're using some Tsukamoto moves. Here's a band, we introduced a band move with a non-alternate crossing. Then we do this untongue move where we just something like a Rademeister 2 with a third strand in the background. So we're doing that here. These are these two regions, are just these two crossings are just going to smooth out. And then we see another one of those regions like this, so we smooth that out again. It's untongue, untongue. Then we get Rademeister 1, Rademeister 2. Okay. What we need to sort of see now is how do we know where to put the bands? The computer, once you get to here, just says follow supermodal moves. How does the computer know to put this band in? That's what I want to worry about next. Okay, so let's see how I'm doing on time. I'm going slow. Okay, so finding bands, so it's probably a good thing I don't have time to demonstrate that stuff. So Gertz says shade in, put a star according to this convention down here. Produce a matrix from that. So this matrix came from looking at all the shaded, no, all the white regions. And at each white region, I put a signed count of the crossings on the diagonal. So it's a 2 here, 2 here, 2 here. This gives a minus 1, because the star crossings contribute minus 1. And on the outside region, we also get a minus 1. In between any two regions, so the off-diagonal entries come again from counting crossings connecting regions with sign, we do it now with the opposite sign. So that in between this crossing counts positively on the diagonal and negatively on the other. This gives us this matrix, then we arbitrarily throw away one of the regions and hence one of the rows of columns. And we call this the black Gertz matrix. So it's somehow associated to the black surface, even though its entries come from the white regions. And similarly, there's a white Gertz, which comes from looking at counting crossings in between and around the shaded regions. Okay, so Gertz told us how to associate two matrices and get some not a link invariance from them back in the 30s. Gordon and Litherland told us that this has a nice four-dimensional interpretation. These matrices are actually the matrix of an intersection form of four manifold that sort of looks a bit like one of these. In fact, it is half of this. If you take one of those black or white circles and push it inside the four ball and take the double branch cover, that matrix gives the intersection on the second homology. Okay, so this is really telling you about a four manifold. Gordon Litherland also generalized this to any embedded manifold, any embedded surface, sorry, any spanning surface for your link. You just, as I said, take the linking number between a curve and the double normal push-off, get the pairing, and it's also then the intersection form of the double branch cover. Gertz matrices of alternating diagrams are definite, and these surfaces are the definite surfaces. I think I told you that already. This gives us an obstruction, which I'll tell you about. It's a theorem. This is a well-known theorem used by many people, in particular used by Paolo Visca when he was looking at two bridge knots. I want to sketch the proof. Now I'm going to look at a couple more versions of this, and I won't bother sketching their proof so much. They're sort of similar. So if you had an alternating knot, which is sliced, what will you do? You'll take the double branch cover of S4. Here's an S3, and here is your knot. Here you'll put one of these lapo-white surfaces. Here you'll put the slice disc. And then you take the double branch cover and, well, you get a four-manifold, which is closed. Here you're getting the double branch cover. Well, who cares what we're getting there? You're getting the double branch cover of the knot. But on this side, your intersection form is given by your Gurwitz. And on this side, you have a rational homology ball. So that's something you can calculate. If you take the double branch cover of a slice disk, you get something with no intersection form, no B2. You get a rational homology ball. So all we're doing is putting that Gurwitz form inside something of the same rank. And this being definite, it gets the same signature as the Gurwitz, Donaldson's diagonalization theorem tells you that basically you're getting, well, the Gurwitz, let's just say we're getting H2, the double branch cover of D4 on this FB, sitting inside a ZN. And in fact, this is an embedding of lattices. Here you have the Gurwitz matrix, and here you just have the identity. And what you can see is that embedding is given by some matrix. You take the standard basis here and some basis here, and your Gurwitz will be given by, well, the columns of your matrix will just be the image of your basis here, and you get their self-intersection by just taking their dot product with themselves, and you get their pairwise intersection by taking dot products with each other, and that just tells you that the Gurwitz matrix is given by A transpose F. Okay? So both this, you can do this to both surfaces, and you can refine this using Haygarth-Fleur theory, but we won't bother with that. We call an alternating diagram for which A and B exist bifactorized. So each of the Gurwitz matrices has this square integer square root matrix. So it's this matrix whose, multiplying it by its transpose gives you back the Gurwitz. So we call this bifactorizable. Slice alternating diagrams have bifactorizable Gurwitz matrices. If you're slice alternating, then you're bifactorizable. Liska in 2007 showed that the two bridge knots, slice and bifactorizable, are the same. This is not true, unfortunately, for alternating in general, so we can't simply use that obstruction to see if something is slice. There are known examples which are bifactorizable but not slice. Here's an example. Stevedore is bifactorizable. So what do? We write the vector in Zn corresponding to each region on the region. So this somehow is giving you these. This picture has these matrices A and B sitting inside it. These, if you like, are in the standard basis for, in this case, Z4 and Z2. These are given the columns of the matrix A. Okay, so in each case, you should see a vector whose dot product with itself counts the crossings around the region, and the dot product with any other region gives you minus the number of crossings connecting. Okay, so if a bifactorizable corresponds to being able to draw some vectors on a diagram like this. Applying a band move to a diagram gives rise to some new ribbon-immersed surfaces, as we've seen before. If you have some surface here, let me draw another picture. picture diagram of your knot. It has some black and white surfaces. If you want to try adding a band, well, you just put it in the diagram somewhere. And if you're lucky, it'll give you an embedded surface. But more generally, it's going to somehow cut through the surface in some way and introduce some ribbon singularity. So it gives you a new, for each of the black and white surfaces, it's going to introduce some ribbon singularity. So you get something new. We can generalize the Gordon-Lithwell pairing to such ribbon surfaces. Adding a band gives one more generator, and you get a new bifactorization condition. It tells you the Gurritz you had before fits inside a matrix of one extra row and column corresponding to the new generator, and the factorization has to extend to something which will now be rectangular, not square. But there's a bifactorization condition. Just go this. So basically, if you draw a band at random, there's something you can check. There's an obstruction using Donaldson's theorem that tells you this may or may not be part of a ribbon diagram, part of a ribbon disk. And this, you know, just comes from taking a little piece inside this. Sort of the double branch cover of that ribbon of our surface is a little bit bigger than what you had before, so it still fits inside this closed format. Donaldson 3, so there's a third obstruction. If your diagram is, and like I said, if it's two component slice link and has only one non-alternating crossing, then we call it minimally non-alternating. So more generally, minimally non-alternating means as close to alternating as you can be given the nullity of your link. And if you have a slice minimally non-alternating link, then you get a bifactorization condition from a similar Donaldson argument. These are again rectangular matrices, but this generalizes the previous condition. So slice with as alternating as you can be given your nullity implies this, some sort of bifactorization on Gurritz. So something checkable. So that's what we're going to say. Algorithmic bands, what are they? They're length two untwisted band moves. They look like this. This is meant to indicate there's a star in one of those positions. Roughly speaking, more complicated bands will never give you almost alternating diagrams. We take the bands that introduce exactly one non-alternating crossing. They look like this. So these are the bands we consider that keep our diagrams in this minimally non-alternating world. And then we check, in each case, do they pass the Donaldson obstructions? So for these, the two previously mentioned obstructions turn out to be equivalent. And OK, so now I can tell you what precisely is the algorithm for fusion number one. So a single band should be converted to the crossingless unlinked diagram, by a single algorithmic band, one of these, followed by a sequence of Tsukamoto moves. Theorem, let's see, all slice two bridge knots of fusion number one algorithm ribbon, and if we run this on the table up to 18 crossings, you get 22,000. And nicely, we don't know any fusion number one alternating knots which are not algorithmic ribbon. So one could conjecture that fusion number one alternating all arise this way. It's kind of reasonable. There are some, well, apart from the experimental evidence, there's some extra obstructions coming from Haygarth-Fleur theory to being fusion number one alternating. There's obstructions to an L space being a single surgery on a knot in S1 times S2 that you could apply here. So there's some tools that you have to try and prove such a conjecture. Also, you have the circumstantial evidence of McCoy's result. Unknotting number one has a nice result. You know, so why not fusion number one as well? Doing a single surgery might be something special. So Tsukamoto's theorem also allows you to, you know, if you want to classify all the fusion number one algorithmic ribbon knots with up to a million crossings, you could set a computer to output those all for you. So this somehow would solve the problem if you could prove that conjecture, which we can't as yet. So now we want to go beyond fusion number one. More bands need more Tsukamoto moves. So here are the Tsukamoto moves we had before at the top of the screen, these four moves: flight, untongue, Why do I want? Here's a couple of extra ones. turns out we need these. It's not surprising that you need this one. Well, it turns out once you start applying two or three bands, that set isn't enough. You're going to need some more Sukumoto moves. A generalized Sukumoto move is either Rytmeister 2 or Flight, or the rest of the things here fall in the following category there. Connected tangle replacement, satisfying. They give you an isotopic well down. In other words, when you do them to a tangle inside your diagram, preserve the isotopic class. They are monotone, so they keep the number of non-alternating crossings, but they decrease the number of alternating crossings, making your diagram simpler. And bifactorizability is preserved, so let me just illustrate that for an example. Bifactorizability here means you can draw some vectors on each of these regions, and it turns out there's a guide here which tells you exactly how to convert back and forth between a bifactorization here and a bifactorization here. So these, if this thing was unobstructed, you don't have to check if that thing would be unobstructed. You can also count, we are, even though we did this strange thing of putting these extra crossings to keep it as close to alternating as possible, we have reduced the number of crossings from left to right. Preserve the number of non-alternating crossings. So these are generalized Sukumoto moves, and there's a couple of conjectures, which I discussed in a problem session yesterday, which I'll skim over now. But basically, depending on how many bands you're using, there should be some finite set of such generalized Sukumoto moves. But there should be, you know, more and more of them as you increase the number of non-alternating crossings. Okay, here's now the Stevedore's algorithmically ribbon in all its glory, showing the bifactorizations. So you might notice, probably won't, but someone could notice that this is not an algorithmic band as I've described it, so I'll justify that very quickly. Why have I drawn a length 1 twisted band instead of a length 2? So the fact is, if you take a version. This is sort of a degenerate case where you take an algorithmic band followed by a Rytmeister 1 and it will give you a length 1 band with a single non-alternating crossing. So that's what I've sort of abbreviated here. Take one step out of the diagram. There's finitely many algorithmic bands. You look for them, find one, check, Sukumoto will simplify it so you're happy. This thing is certifiably sliced. Here are search results. Kirby Calculator, there will at some point be a version of Kirby Calculator that you can download and run this ribbon algorithm yourself. So far it's not publicly available, even though Kirby Calculator does lots of other nice things. We use the prime alternating knot generator by Flint, Rankin, and Rees to produce the tables, generate the tables. So you see there are up to 18 crossings, 10 million total. First thing you do, you know that slice knots, it follows, if you like, from the bifactorization condition, but it's well known for easier reasons, have to have a square determinant. So you kick out an awful lot of those knots, you find out there's only 125,000 to look at. Then you check how many of those are bifactorizable, and you see that at first most of the square determinant ones are bifactorizable. As you go on, that's becoming a bit more special. In general, less than half this total amount. And then how many of those are algorithmically ribbon? So here you see how many of those. Something like half in total are, you know, that could possibly be ribbon turn out to be demonstrably ribbon. This shows how many bands we need to use. So for up to 11 crossings, you never need more than one band. The first two-bander appears at 12 crossings. And so this is indicating that here there were 301 that only needed one band. Four examples that need two bands. Down here you need, at 18 crossings, the first three-bander appears. Now we do not know that the seven examples we find that need three bands in our algorithm actually have fusion number 3. It could be that there's some non-algorithmic disk that has a single, or a, well, let's say two bands, probably not single. There are some ways you can check that, but we haven't. It's really interesting, something, the first slice knot is this one, and it has 6 crossings. First 2 binder appears at 12 crossings, the first 3 binder appears at 18 crossings. What's going on there? Not quite sure. Yeah, I think Frank is starting to run 19 crossings to see what happened there, but presumably we won't see any 4 binders until we start running 24 crossings. I'd be very surprised. I will finish by showing you an example. I'll tell you about this. So we know that not all slice knots are algorithmic driven. So Axel Seale, I think, was an undergraduate student in maybe Stuttgart. He ran a search looking for these things, symmetric unions, and checking their Humphrey polynomial to see if they matched up to something unknown in the table. We found a 12 crossing knot and a 13 and a 15, I can't remember. He found 3 examples which were previously not known to be ribbon, and in fact they don't show up as algorithmic ribbon. So our algorithm is certainly not finding all slice logically knots, sadly. We've sent out about 100 examples by doing some ad hoc stuff. In all cases, they have 2 band disks, where you start with a length 3 band that introduces 2 non-alternating crossings, so it goes outside this minimally non-alternating world, but then there's some large, ugly isotopy that gets you back to minimally non-alternating, and then there's an algorithmic band for the second one. So somehow they stay quite close for the algorithm, they just step outside for a few minutes and then come back. This is not very satisfactory. We'd like to understand what's going on a bit better and find more examples. Fusion number 1 may be reasonable conjecture, but those are all showing up in the algorithm. Is there a reasonable way to enlarge the algorithm? That's something we'd love to find. And finally, I want to look at this example. This is a 3-band example. If my laptop wasn't dying, I'd show you the sequence of band moves and isotopies, but that's not possible, so I will stop there. Thank you.
Is it true that the minimum number of bands for Bendis can be quite large?
Yeah, I think there are some known low bounds and they can be arbitrary. There's some papers. I can't tell you what they use, but I've seen some at some point. If you wanted, I could look something up. Yeah.
So I guess when you're trying to find this ribbon disk, I mean, you have to pick these arcs to do your band move on. And I mean, there's other times with knots you're looking for arcs, like if you're looking for a knotting moves,
yes.
Or for like finding the tunnel number of the knot. I mean, do you have any intuition about are the arcs you're picking here similar to the ones you use for, say, these other purposes, or are they disjoint, or?
So the partial answer that I could give, I don't think this is, probably I don't know, but something in that direction is that any time you find something that's algorithmic like this, you're getting one of these almost alternating unlinked diagrams. Let's suppose it was a single band. So you could change that crossing. And now what you have is a unlinking number 1 alternating link. So somehow there's a very close relation between the ribbon problem and the alternating unlinking number 1, or alternating unlinking problem, maybe. That's not quite answering your question. No, I don't know.